year, over 2 million people are traveling to Mecca. They're already in Mecca, and they're practicing something called Hajj, which is one of the practices of Islam for you to be identified as a Muslim. As they do these things, one of the things they do is stoning the devil in Mecca, in Kaaba. And then other thing is...
The Antichrist, isn't it?
And then other thing is...
That's the mother of the Antichrist.
Sorry?
That's the mother of the Antichrist.
I am Christian, and Islam is an Antichrist religion, sir. Yes, I know. And I know Muhammad is Antichrist as well. Thank you for helping us to remember that.
That's the mother of the Antichrist.
So one of the practices they do is they stone the devil in Kaaba, and then other thing they do is they kiss the black stone. Can you just tell me why do Muslims do that?
It's part of the ritual.
Why?
Like I said, I don't
so there are think very practical. 2 million people are going and kissing the same stone. Okay? Reason is for that because according to Islamic tradition, Muhammad did it. So what would you say to a man who's supposed to be the best example to mankind, goes and then kiss a black stone and worshipping the stones that are part of the pagan practice in 7th century and before 7th century?
How is it worshipping the stone?
Oh, you don't think it is worshipping the stone while expressing the love towards the black stone?
If you kiss your mom, it doesn't mean that you're worshipping.
Yeah, you kiss your mom, I kiss my dogs, you kiss people, you say hi to them, and no one thinks I am worshipping my mom. But something happens with Muslims, and black stone helps me to think Muslims are worshipping the black stone. Let me give you the supporting verse for that. I heard Messenger of Allah saying, touching the black stones atones for the sins. On the Messenger of Allah said about the black stone, by Allah, Allah will raise it on the day of resurrection with two eyes, by which it says, and a tongue that speaks with, testifies to whoever touched it. So, as you kiss the black stone, as you touch the black stone, that black stone on the day of judgment is going to testify for you, sir. How this is not worshipping a black stone?
Well, if we were worshipping it, then we wouldn't need, then the black stone wouldn't need to testify for you on the day of judgment, because they could just atone you itself. But it goes to the higher being, which is Allah. So if it really was God, it wouldn't need to go to Allah and testify. It's similar to how the Prophet Muhammad would testify for you.
Sorry, can you just unpack that for us?
Pardon?
Can you just unpack, expand what you are saying?
Yes, yeah, so you're making the claim that because the black stone will testify for you to Allah, it will be, it's as if it's being a god. But if, surely if it was a god...
I didn't say it's a god.
You said we worship
it. Yeah. Muslims are not only worshipping Allah, Muslims are worshipping lots of other things alongside of Allah. So I am saying, as you express your love to black stone, as you kiss the black stone, you are expecting that black stone is going to atone for your sins. Who can only atone for the sins? Who can testify? How can black stone can testify that you kissed it? Think very practically, sir. 2018, 2 million people are in Hajj, and their goal is to do the tawaf and then kiss the black stone this year, 2018. Last year, there were again approximately 2 million people. So black stone needs to remember on the day of judgment who kissed it, the black stone in 2018. Who kissed the black stone in 2016, 2017, or any time from 600s? How can how can black stone has the attributes of God, and how can black stone be all-knowing and all-powerful? Because black stone needs to remember the name and identity of 2 million people in 2018, and many more million people in the past, and many more million people in the future.
So you know, if you're all powerful or all knowing, it means that your omniscience is basically it's not contingent on anyone. So you know, the black stone, it's this knowledge of just who kissed it. Is it contingent or is it necessary? Is it necessary knowledge? Is it independent?
So let me ask you a very simple question. Here's English. I need help with that, okay? Because you know my English is not very good. So how can an object which doesn't breathe out life, okay, doesn't breathe, doesn't grow, have a conscience? How can an object can remember the things?
Yes, conscience means with knowledge. So it can't.
So as an English person, you think it can't. So, and you are you English? No, okay. But you are living in England, yet you are Muslim. For you, stone, an object has a knowledge. Can you just explain to me how can an object has a knowledge?
Yeah, God can give it knowledge. It's not that hard.
So Allah give an object knowledge on the day of judgment, because Allah couldn't remember who went to Hajj and kissed the black stone.
Allah
needs a help from the object.
It's not really he needs your help. Just because he's asking it, even will be questioned, it doesn't mean that Allah needs us to remember. Because if that's the case, right, if Allah asked us, it doesn't mean that that it's like we're kind of reminding him. Because at the same time, Allah will ask us on the day of judgment, and some people will lie, and then Allah will correct them. So if Allah is simply asking us for us to remind him, then how is it that he's able to correct us?
So, here's my problem. You are human being, okay? A black stone, in its name, it's a stone, okay? So as a human being, you've got millions of brain cells, you've got tongue, you've got mouth, you've got eyes, you are living, breathing human beings. You are thinking, you are exercising your brain, you are studying to remember things, you are studying to learn new things. But a black stone, and reason it's a black stone, what is the reason it's a black stone, sir?
Because of what Adam did when he ate the forbidden fruit.
Where does it say that?
I'm not sure about the...
It doesn't say that, I'll help you out.
Okay.
It is because of the sins of Adam. It was white, not because he ate the apple.
Yeah, that was his sin.
Eat the apple.
Yeah.
Where does it say he ate the
forbidden fruit?
Where does it say that?
In Surah Baqarah, when it says...
Let's look at the verse. Open the verse for me. While you open the verse, I'm going to make my point. Why would Allah asking you to kiss something which represents the sin of mankind, and that stone is going to atone for your sins, and on the day of judgment, that stone is going to testify for you, going to intercede for you? So, since you've got a principle, it looks like part of your character that you say something and you can't find the verses, I'm going to ignore that, okay? So, because you can't back it up. So that will be your homework.
Just because I doesn't Just because I don't know something doesn't mean I've made it.
Aren't you googling that?
No, I haven't got data. You know when it says,
thank you, David.
When it says in the Quran that we told, he said, dwell you and your wealth dwell in the gardens, but do not go near that tree. And then Shaitan tricked them. I think it's in Surah Al-A'raf. It says, and then after Allah tricked them, Shaitan tricked them, and they ate from the tree, and then their body, their private parts were exposed.
So let me read it for you. Surah 2, okay? And when we said to angels, prostrate before Adam, so they prostrate, except for Iblis. He refused and was arrogant and became one of the disbelievers. And we said, oh Adam, dwell you and your wife in paradise and eat therefrom in abundance from wherever you will. But do not approach this tree, lest you be among the wrongdoers. But Satan caused them to slip out of it and remove them from that in which they had been. And we said, go down as enemies to one another, and you will have upon the earth a place of settlement and provision for a time. So this is the verse you were looking,
yeah,
and this verse doesn't say they eat the fruit, okay? It doesn't say that. It says Satan caused them to slip out while Allah tell them to don't approach this tree.
Yeah, sorry, so, I found it. It's in Surah 7, chapter number 19 to 20.
Surah 7?
Yeah, it says...
Surah 7 verse?
19 to 20. Draw you and your wife in paradise and eat from wherever you will, but do not approach this tree, lest you be amongst the wrongdoers.
Yes, I'm waiting to the part which says they eat the fruit.
So what has this got to do with
Just a moment. So now we established that you made a claim, and now you see Quran doesn't help you to back up that claim.
No,
Quran doesn't say... No, Quran does. Did you read it for me from the Quran? They eat the fruit.
Yeah, it says, and do not eat from wherever, but do not approach this tree.
So do not approach this tree versus they ate the fruit from the tree are two different things. Okay? Even English is my second language. They are two different things.
Where are you quoting from?
Surah 7 verse starts from verse... it goes from verse 10 to 23.
Okay.
Even goes like
really the claim that you're trying to...
So we just established you made a claim which you cannot back it up. So now let's go to the original. My question was to you, why do you kiss something symbolize the sins of people? So black stone was white as milk, and then it become a black because of the sin of mankind. Okay, sin of Adam. Why do you kiss that? Why would Allah tell you to kiss something symbol of the sin?
What's that got to do with us worshipping?
So first answer the question, I'm gonna make my point.
Okay, so the reason why is because that was just a blessing that Allah sent down from the heaven. It's the only thing that we actually have from Jannah. But then it's just been blackened because of our sins.
So you've got an object from Jannah, from paradise, which was white in the beginning, but it turned out to be black because of the sin of mankind, and Allah told you to kiss that because that's a blessing from Allah.
Yeah.
I don't see that as a blessing. Can you just tell me, how do you see that as a blessing?
Because it came from heaven.
Hatun, one question. Isn't it in the Quran it says, oh Muhammad, if you're in doubt, go to the people of the book.
Go to the people of the book.
Do you know the verse?
7157 or 1094? 1094. So if you are in it...
For him. Where is it?
So this one.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay, 1 second.
I want it back.
Yeah, okay? I'm coming.
Sorry. So can you just tell me, how can it be a blessing to kiss something symbolize the sin?
I'm torches because it came from the heavens.
But it symbolizes sin.
Okay, but it still came from Jannah. So.
But it symbolizes the sin.
Okay. I don't see the point that you're trying to say that we worship it.
So you don't see there is any problem that you are kissing something which symbolizes a sin, and you are kissing that with that sinful which symbolizes sin with hoping that is going to atone for your sins, okay? Can you just tell me what kind of attributes a stone, an object, must have to atone for the sin of mankind? Sin of people who kissed it.
Your claim doesn't really make sense, to be honest, because
first, where's Godwin? Thank you, yeah? Where's Godwin?
I don't know.
Because first you're saying that is something that we worship, and then now you're trying to belittle it.
Hello, sir. I am breaking it down to show how you are worshipping the black stone by kissing it. First, I emphasize that black stone is the symbol of the sin, okay? It came from paradise. It is a symbol of the sin. And for those who kissed it and who touched it, that black stone is going to atone for your sins, okay?
So
how an object can atone for your sins?
You still haven't answered my question, which was...
I'm breaking it down for you to understand. It seems we are having a communication breakdown here. So I'm breaking it down for you. So how can an object which symbolizes sin can atone for the sin of those people who touched it?
Because Allah allows it to on the day of judgment.
So Allah is going to give one of his attributes to a stone on the day of judgment.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. When you give the attributes of Allah to someone or something, what do you call that?
I know you're trying to lead me to. You're trying to make me say shirk, but this isn't an example of.
Okay. Is it not correct if someone or something takes the attributes of Allah attributes of Allah is given to something or someone, that is a shirk?
So are you trying to make the claim that because...
No, I am asking.
No, I'm
the definition of the shirk. One of the definition for the shirk, you know, there are like three lines. One of them is partnering with Allah, one of them is giving the attributes of Allah to something and someone. Is that shirk or not?
It's not shirk. And I'll tell you why, because...
So, giving the attributes of Allah to black stone is not a shirk.
How is it an attribute of Allah?
Is not the attributes of Allah, Allah is all-forgiving. It is not the attributes of Allah, Allah is all-loving. Allah is all-powerful. Allah is all-present.
How is the stone all-powerful? If all it knows is the people that kiss...
So, how can stone be all-powerful? Remembers to who kissed it. From 7th century, let's say, just sake of the argument, end of the life is tomorrow, okay? From 7th century to 21st century, 14 centuries, okay? Approximately 1,400 years. This stone must remember who kissed it. This stone must remember who kissed it. For stone to remember, what kind of brain stone must have to remember all those kind of things. All the name of those people. When they kissed it, which day they kissed it, who are those people. For stone to remember all those things, stone must be all-knowing and all-powerful.
Not necessarily, because
if you look at
something contingently, its knowledge is contingent upon Allah. So
what does that mean?
It means that it relies on Allah. So Allah,
okay.
Okay.
Just a moment. I don't know that word. So knowledge of the Quran. Explain.
Okay.
Please.
So there's two types of, like, when it comes to like knowledge, power, and so on. There's something called contingent, which means it relies on another being, like the universe. is contingent. It exists just like Allah exists, but it's contingent. And if you go back, it's contingent on a God. And we're both theists and we believe that a God created it. But just because the universe exists and Allah also exists, it is not an act of shirk because it is contingent on another being, which is God. Yeah, we both believe that.
Okay, so I understand your point.
Then you have something which is necessary. So a being which is necessary doesn't rely on another being. For example, like the God that we both believe in, God, we don't believe that God is contingent upon another being for its existence, its power, its knowledge, and so on. It has necessary knowledge, which means that it does not rely on anyone. So even the black stone, when it has knowledge, its knowledge is contingent upon Allah. That's why.
So, I want you to back it up for me. Can you just show me the hadith which backs up your claim?
What? Okay,
knowledge of black stone is dependent on Allah. Can you just back that up?
It's Sahih Muslim, chapter number 16. Hadith number 7.
Let's open it.
Yeah. It says there's no might or power except by Allah.
That does not answer my question. My question is very simple. Where did you get the idea that heavenly being, which was white stone, turned to be black stone because of the sin of mankind, is depend on Allah in his knowledge? Because the verse doesn't tell you Allah will remind the black stone. Verse tells you black stone is going to atone for your sins. Allah has nothing to do in that hadith, sir.
Okay, so do you understand the difference between contingent and necessary?
Sir,
do you
just answer my question. Make it simple. I am like lay Christian. Can you just make it simple for me?
Hatun, what do you want to know?
So you didn't listen to my question.
No, you're asking for a hadith where it says...
Yeah, so the hadith, I read it for you. It states black stone by itself going to atone for those who touched it.
Where
okay?
Does it say it's going to be on its own in that hadith?
It doesn't say with the power of Allah. It says touching them atones for your sins.
No, but where does
day
it say
of resurrection with two eyes. It doesn't, like, you are the one who brought that up. So this verse, this hadith by itself, gives us the impression that hadith clearly tells us it is Blackstone who is going to do that. Blackstone is going to remember, David kissed me, I am going to atone for his sins. Blackstone is going to remember, Isaac kissed me, I am going to atone sins of Isaac. It doesn't tell Allah is going to step in and do something, Allah is going to remind him anything. It says it is Blackstone who is going to testify for people who touched it. And it is Blackstone, touching the Blackstone is going to erase your sins.
Okay,
it has nothing to do with Allah.
So you still haven't shown where in the hadith it says that it will do it independently without the power of Allah. And also you haven't answered my claim, the hadith where in Sahih Muslim, book number 16, hadith number 7, where it says there is no might or power except by Allah.
So,
those two.
So you are bringing me hadith which contradicts what I am reading to you. It already confirms that you cannot trust hadith. If there is nothing without power of Allah, then why Allah is giving his attributes to other people? Couple of weeks ago, I already showed you Allah, Jesus had the power of God to create faster than Allah. So now you are forcing me to put a phrase here that Blackstone is going to do that independently. For me to prove you that phrase, first you need to prove me a phrase which tells you Blackstone is not depend on Allah or independent to Allah or depend
I'm not,
on
I'm
Allah.
Not the one making the
no,
claims.
You are the one.
What was the verse again? Sorry.
1094. So you are the one, who is assuming Blackstone is depend on Allah. In that side, part of Allah, which was a stone in heaven, part of Allah entered this world, and then become a black stone with the sins of people, and people just kissed it. And then as you kiss it, as you touch it, it's going to erase your sins. It doesn't tell you Allah is helping the black stone to erase your sins. It simply says black stone, touching the black stone erases your sins. So what kind of power this black stone has, which symbolizes the sin?
First of all, I already told you that the hadith which says there's no might or power except by Allah, which means that
that is nothing to do with me. That is nothing to do with me, and it just confirms. Okay, just wait. Just one second, okay? Where is my book?
It's not out yet.
It's not out yet?
Yeah, for some reason. I don't know why it's not out yet.
Okay. Is he alright?
I don't know, to be honest. I'm a bit concerned.
You haven't visited him?
No, I haven't.
I thought he was your friend. You haven't visited him? So how can this black stone has power through kiss to atone for the sins?
Okay, so what I was trying to tell you was that there is no might or power except Allah, and that includes all the creation, including a black stone. I remember you gave an example last week about JC. If he wanted to punch you, he has the power to do so, but that power is contingent upon Allah. If Allah didn't give him the power to do so, he wouldn't be able to do it. So similarly, the same way that a black stone can atone for your sins is only through the power of Allah that he can do so. And secondly, you haven't been able to show me where in the hadith where it says that it will do it independently. Whereas I have given you a hadith which shows that there is no might or power except Allah. So in order for you to discredit my claim, you have to show me a hadith, as you're the accusing party, where it says that the black stone will atone your sins, our sins, sorry, on its own.
Okay, so you touch something. I'm not going to talk about it. We talk. That's a different topic. We will talk about it later regarding power and permission. People's power, JC's power, was not depend on Allah. Probably Allah had nothing to do with that. So I am going to read the verse for you. And I want you to tell from this verse how this links with Allah, okay? Touching black stones erases your sin.
Okay, you still haven't said where it's
touching the black. Sir, touching the black, it doesn't say. Don't play that stupid verb junks with me, okay? You are old enough for that. Don't play that silly game. You can simply say, I don't know how to defend it. I'll come back to you next week. The hadith is here clearly, tells it, touching it will erase your sin. Kissing it is going to atone for your sin. It doesn't say kissing black stone, Allah and black stone is going to atone for your sins. Kissing the black stone and Quran is going to atone for your sins. It doesn't say black stone is alone. It is alone. Okay? So, do you want to go home and then check, do your homework and come back? Or do you want to just play with independent verbs game? That game doesn't work with me.
But you still haven't answered the hadith where it says there's no might or power except by Allah.
So, okay. No might and power except Allah. And then in here, I have a hadith which tells us black stone is powerful to intercede for people who kissed it. I have hadiths which tells us, Quranic verses, which tells us Jesus is powerful enough to create faster than Allah. For you to bring me that hadith simply says to me, Islam messed up, there is a big contradictions in hadith. I don't care. You've got hadith which says Allah is almighty and powerful. I am asking the question, how can black stone, which the symbolize of the sin, came from heaven? It is according to Islamic tradition, only heavenly being in this earth, came from heaven, turned black because of the sin of the mankind. is powerful enough to forgive you, atone for your sins, by just one kiss. That's the question I'm asking. That is shirk. It is shirk because attributes of Allah is giving to not any human beings, but giving to the object, which is the symbolize of the sin. That's it. Okay?
So I don't think I can really have the discussion properly because you don't know the difference between contingent power and necessary power. So if I do try to explain it to you, you won't really understand it.
You already explained, you already gave me the definition of it. And how did you come to the conclusion that I didn't have the brain that to understand that?
I'm not trying to...
From that, we already understand that you call me stupid, that's fine.
No, I said I'm not trying to...
Still, my question stands. How come...
When are you going to stop lying about Islam and start preaching about your... Are you ashamed of your own religion?
Give me five things I lied about Islam. Give me five things I lied about Islam. Give me five things I lied about Islam.
Everything that you talk about is filthy lies.
Okay. So everything I say is supposed to be the...
Everything that comes out of your filthy mouth is a filthy lie. And you have been shown and proven to be a filthy liar by many of the...
So brothers. Thank you for all the compliments.
And you need to
Islam does to mankind. Here's the thing. I ask you to give me five things I lied about Islam. And you said everything I say is a lie. I am saying Muhammad is a false prophet.
Thank
you. Stop lying about Christian faith.
You don't lie.
That's a problem.
Filthy liar.
Well, that's what you're doing.
This filthy liar every week interrupts this discussion and comes up with a filthy lie.
So give me five things Five things brought you to speaker's corner to tell me I am filthy liar. Five things.
Filthy liar. That's the only thing I need to tell you. You are a filthy liar.
May Lord Jesus shine his face upon you. May Lord Jesus bring you to repentance. Because on the day of judgment, you will have to bow down to Lord Jesus Christ. On the day of judgment, you will confess that Jesus is the Lord.
Are you ashamed of your religion?
I see what Islam does to people. It looks like you are brainwashed from this lovely book. Maybe this brother can teach you a little bit manners. That will be very, very helpful. If you are not going to give me five things I lied about Islam, can I encourage you to move away, please? Because you are entering my space now.
Actually, this is what you do. Every Muslim debate, this is what you do. You stand in every Muslim debate and you spout your filthy lies. You actually can't keep yourself to yourself. Why don't you get on a podium and preach about your gospel instead of spreading your filthy lies?
My gospel because simply says, Islam is a false religion. People who follow the religions of Islam identifies Jesus as they are antichrist and they are denying Jesus.
Why do you talk to this filthy liar? She's been shown to be a filthy liar time and time
again. I ask you to give me five reasons. Give me the five examples. No example. That is what Islam is. They just lie like Allah. They lie like Muhammad. They are people who represent this Quran. So, just a moment, just Isaac, he just called me filthy liar, and then you said you know that.
Did you under any student of knowledge? So, I was going to ask you whether you studied under any sheikh, but I went to the bottom and asked you whether you studied under some students of knowledge, and you haven't, and you come here to give dawah. Allah says, don't talk about the Quran if you have no knowledge of it. That's why people like me don't
Allah
come
doesn't
here and
want,
debate about
yeah.
the Quran. Because
so he doesn't come to Quran to debate,
studied,
but he comes to Quran to accuse people.
You can't debate with these filthy liars. Otherwise, you make yourself look like a fool because you have no knowledge.
You are just making your brother look like a fool.
No, I'm talking to him. I'm not calling him a filthy liar. I'm calling you a filthy liar.
Sir, are you okay that your brother used such a language for me?
I'm not getting involved.
Oh, you are not getting involved. Silent, this is alright. So, I ask you a very simple question. If I lie at speaker's corner, I am here, bring the evidence to confront of me. Confront me. I am here. What I say, simple things. I say simple things, and they are very, very simple. Muhammad is false prophet. Muslims confirm that. Islam is a dangerous ideology. Example here. Allah is a liar. Muhammad is a liar. Muslims are liar. We see the examples here. That is all I
said. Muhammad is in the Bible.
Sorry?
I said Prophet Muhammad is mentioned in your scriptures. You know, in your scriptures, Muhammad is mentioned in the Jewish Bible. In the Jewish Bible, he's mentioned my name. In the song of Solomon.
Can you show me? Where is it?
It's in the Song of Solomon.
Where?
But it's in there. You have a look.
Give me the passage. Give me the name of the chapter.
I know it's in the Song of Solomon. You will find the name of Muhammad mentioned. And
so,
I think
I am Christian. I read my Bible every day.
I haven't seen
Muhammad mentioned in the Songs of Solomon.
He's mentioned
give
in the Bible
me the reference.
As well.
Give me the reference.
He's mentioned in the Bible.
Give
as well.
Me the reference. Muhammad is mentioned in the Bible as a false prophet. Whom should put to death in the Old Testament and in the New Testament? That it is all Bible says. In Deuteronomy 18, false prophet put to death. Matthew chapter 24, false prophet. That is all it is. That is all it is. Show me. Show me. I told you what my scripture tells you.
You don't believe in the Bible?
I told you what my scripture tells you. Where?
In the Song of Solomon, what? Prophet Muhammad is mentioned in Deuteronomy 18:18.
Okay, let me tell you.
I think it's Deuteronomy chapter 18:18.
Okay, so,
right?
So one of them, you said Songs of Solomon. I'm gonna.
Hatun, are we having our discussion?
No, we are not having our discussion because your brother accused me and you supported
You're
him.
Since
I'm not getting
yeah, that's supporting. I know in Islam, silence means yes, all right. That's what Muhammad did. So. When you get the manners right, we will discuss. So, sir, songs, all together eight chapters.
I told her it's in the Song of Solomon, Prophet Muhammad is mentioned by name.
Yeah, so it is eight chapters. It's eight chapters. Can you just tell me? Where it is?
I'm not a Bible scholar, but I know it's in there. If I was a Bible
okay.
scholar, you know what I mean?
I am Christian. Okay, I am not a scholar. Songs of Solomon,
yes.
Eighth chapter,
yes.
And Muhammad is not dead.
Okay, because that's
you
why you
push.
Don't. That's
you
why you
force.
Don't understand it.
You butcher.
Who is Muhammad?
Still,
who is Muhammad?
Muhammad is not dead.
No.
Muhammad is in the Old Testament. Deuteronomy chapter 18. False prophet should put to death. Your brother left. So let's just summarize what happened. Muslim comes to speaker's corner to tell us we are lying.
Because you are lying because you don't understand it. You don't
asking
understand it.
Simple example of give me five things I lied. No example, but I am a filthy liar.
That's why
that already shows me Islam is a false religion, Muhammad is a false prophet, Quran is a false book.
As
Muslims tries to force Muhammad in the Songs of Solomon, they are just simply telling us Allah is a false. I've got nothing to talk to you on that, sir.